You're listening to WNJC 1360 AM in Washington Township, New Jersey. Up next, Repatriot Radio.
Dan Haggerty here. Welcome to the Baer Haggerty Offensive. Dan, what's up?
Hey, Billy, how are you?
I'm all right, I guess. How are you?
Not too bad. A lot of weird stuff going on. You called me the other day. You told me to check out Obama to unleash truth squads to counter negative coverage. Now, isn't that the same thing they've been doing already? They have bloggers and people like that writing contrary internet publications and things like that.
Well, they had in 08, they had to fight the smears campaign, and they've had similar things with that, attack watch, things like that. But this is actually employing, and I don't mean necessarily paying, although that might be part of it, but using, believe it or not, law enforcement in various states, actually swing states, the swing states that are listed. Iowa.
Do what? Using law enforcement to do what?
Well, we'll get to that. Swing states: Iowa, Michigan, New Hampshire, New Mexico, North Carolina, Wisconsin, Arizona, Colorado, Minnesota, Nevada, Ohio, and Virginia. Basically, using law enforcement to form these truth squads. And
excuse me. Did you say truth squads?
Yes, truth squads. And they're supposedly going to go around and set the record straight regarding Obama and things that are being said about him personally and about his record.
Now, let me get this right. You're telling me that law enforcement officials, employees of states...
Well, unless you don't consider sheriffs and prosecutors law enforcement.
Yeah, really. Officers of the court, exactly, are going to be employed essentially to support Obama's political campaign. Now, isn't that illegal on the face of it?
Well, I don't know. Everything lately seems illegal on the face of it, but it doesn't seem to make much difference. It's just absolutely chilling to think that we're going to have law enforcement setting the record straight regarding the President of the United States.
Oh, yeah, we'll get to that.
Anyway, Dan, the clip, let's play this clip, because this sums it up. This was a news clip, News 4 news clip from Missouri, and this is what they're talking about.
Let's see if I could get this going here.
WNJC 1360 AM, Washington Township, Philadelphia. Philadelphia's Renaissance Radio Station, broadcasting online at WNJC1360.com, a service of Forsyth Broadcasting.
A little exercise didn't work, but basically, that was a news report saying that the Obama administration is going to have the same Fight the Smears campaign that they had in 08. And they're going to have, again, this truth squad in Missouri, which vowed to arrest anyone telling lies about Obama.
It seems to be unclear with the arrest. I mean, they didn't say arrest. The article says arrest, but whatever it is, like I said, the idea that prosecutors and sheriff's offices are being used to enforce what they say is the truth regarding Barack Obama is just disturbing. Doesn't even communicate it anymore. But that's the outrage of the week.
That's amazing. That's I mean, how many precedents do you have for that? You've got the SS, you've got the Gestapo, you've got the KGB. I mean, you know, this is right out of George Orwell. You know, lies are truth. It's unbelievable. The Ministry of Truth. That's how George Orwell described it. So, it says here in the text. Now, this is off of Infowars.com, but it says here in the text of the article that one Obama Truth Squad in Missouri is vowing to arrest anyone telling lies about Obama. I mean, that's just outrageous. What would be the charges?
Failure to comply. I don't know. I don't know. I can't imagine. I mean,
that's like right out of a 1930s movie where the Gestapo kicks down the door and says, "You are under arrest. You have maligned the party."
Speaking ill of the leader.
It's just amazing. So this qualifies to me as an outrage against the Constitution. I mean, it's just unbelievable.
Well, add it to the long list.
Oh, exactly.
Well, anyway, talking about the Constitution, I know this is going to sound kind of weird. We got a dog about a year ago, and we're debating about the dog's name. What are we going to call it? I've been embroiled in these constitutional issues for almost 4 years now. And I'm thinking totally along the lines of the Constitution. The dog's a female. We were going to go with Jefferson. Figured, you know, TJ is the man on a lot of this stuff. But I couldn't think of a way to make Jefferson sound feminine. So we went with Madison. So that's the story of the dog's name. But, Dan, we're going to discuss some things today about Madison the person.
Exactly. We're going to discuss James Madison, who is one of the founders of our Constitution. And we're going to discuss a book called James Madison and the Making of America. The author of the book is also the author of the New York Times bestseller, The Politically Incorrect Guide to the Constitution, Virginia's American Revolution, and with co-author Thomas E. Woods, Who Killed the Constitution? The Federal Government versus American Liberty from World War I to Barack Obama. Our guest is also a professor of history at Western Connecticut State University and lives in Bethel, Connecticut. Welcome, Kevin Gutzman.
Hello, I'm happy to be here.
Hey, Dr. Gutzman, how are you? It's Billy here.
Very well, thanks.
Well, we're going to talk about this Truth Squad issue and some other constitutional issues much later, but we need to talk about your book. We need to talk about one of the architects of the Constitution, James Madison. And, we read your book. It's fascinating the amount of detail you go into in describing how our Constitution was created. Just quite interesting, I got to say.
Thank you much. I appreciate that.
Sure. What was your motivation for concentrating on Madison as opposed to any of the other authors of the Constitution?
Well, what happened essentially was that over a period of about 18 years writing about the American Revolution and the Constitution in general, I kept coming back to issues related to Madison. And so over time, as scholars will do, I published several peer-reviewed articles in scholarly journals saying, well, you know, this little area of what we thought about Madison, the main view is incorrect, and that little area, our opinion of Madison is incorrect. And after I got several of such articles, I realized, you know, the only way I'm going to make this case generally is to write a book about Madison. So it's kind of that he pulled me to him and not the other way around.
I see. Well, it was very interesting. In the first few pages of the book, you talk about what is Madison's greatest accomplishment. Really, his insertion of a clause into the Constitution for religious freedom. I mean, it was basically his development, and it goes back to something that you pointed out he wrote in Virginia called the Memorial and Remonstrance Against Religious Assessments, which basically was kind of an anti-establishment clause. Is that correct?
Well, really what happened was that when he was 25 years old in his very first elected political office, Madison was the youngest fellow who participated in writing the first American Declaration of Rights, which was the Virginia Declaration of Rights of 1776. And besides being a member of that convention, he also was appointed to the committee chaired by George Mason, charged with writing a rough draft of a state constitution and of a Declaration of Rights. So when Mason's committee reported out their draft Declaration of Rights, it included a religion provision that said people in Virginia would be entitled to, quote, the fullest toleration, unquote, in matters of religion. Madison objected to this, although it was the most liberal, that is to say, liberty-minded position that people were taking in the English-speaking world at the time. He objected to the idea of toleration by saying the toleration implied essentially that the government knew better than you but was going to put up with your incorrect opinion for now. And Madison said, well, what really we ought to say is that people in Virginia are going to be entitled to, quote, the free exercise of religion. Once he heard this argument, George Mason agreed with it and endorsed Madison's idea, which the convention then adopted unanimously. We know, of course, that Madison later was the chief draftsman of the Federal Bill of Rights, and so we find that same language in the Federal Bill of Rights, but it really originated in that Virginia development, beside which, as you said, Madison was the author of an explanation of what freedom of religion was about, the Memorial and Remonstrance Against Religious Assessments. That was a pamphlet that Madison wrote in the context of debate in Virginia over whether they should have a complete disestablishment. And what happened was that Patrick Henry, the most popular politician in Virginia, proposed in the mid-1780s that there should be what he called a general assessment. So instead of having a state church, as Virginia had had during the colonial period, Henry said that what they ought to do is continue to collect religion taxes from every resident of Virginia, but allow each person to designate which Protestant congregation his money would go to. So if you're a Baptist, you could say, I want my money to go to a local Baptist, or if you were a Presbyterian, you could say it was going to go to a local Presbyterian. And Madison's argument was that this idea was harmful both to government and to religion, and he made the most radical evangelical case of the time against the idea of state support for religion or religious support for the state. So ultimately, the legislature defeated Henry's bill, and then Madison dusted off his friend Thomas Jefferson's 8-year-old, 9-year-old proposal for a religious liberty bill instead. So ultimately, it was Madison, not Jefferson, who got the Virginia Statute for Religious Freedom passed, too. Madison remained really interested in this principle through his political career, and, for example, as president, twice had occasion to veto congressional bills that he thought transgressed upon the principle of disestablishment. One time Congress decided to give land to a local congregation in part of the District of Columbia, and Madison said, now, religious neutrality means that we can't have anything to do with either supporting or opposing religion, and so veto. In his old age, after he got out of politics, Madison privately wrote that he didn't think there should be chaplains in Congress because whatever chaplain you chose, you're going to be offending people who were going to be having to pay to support the religion that chaplain stood for instead of their own, and so Madison said there shouldn't be any such functionaries. This was, to him, a supremely important principle, and my opinion is that although we likely would have ended up with something structured somewhat like our current federal government, even if there hadn't been any James Madison, this idea of religious liberty is the most important American political idea.
So, Dr. Gutzman, Madison's concept of the interrelationship between the government and the practice of religion and the interplay of religion with society, how does that inform what's going on today with, it was just last week, I guess, and obviously it's going to be carrying through for quite some time now, with HHS, the implementation of Obamacare, essentially, my understanding, mandating that religious and quasi-religious institutions be required to comply with certain birth control measures or insurance for birth control and things of that nature. How does that play in, just to bring it to a modern, contemporary circumstance?
Well, I think it's fair to say that both parties currently are egregiously violating Madison's principle of religious disestablishment. Let me start with the Republican primary campaign.
Well, how about just initially with that specific example?
Well, I actually want to
more broadly.
Okay, that what you pointed to is only a part of the controversy about the Obama mandate. So,
okay, well, why don't you frame the mandate how you understand it and then comment on it?
Okay, well. Okay, what happened was that Obama's administration announced that they were going to require everybody who was providing health insurance to cover various devices and medical procedures that many religious people in America, most notably the largest one, the Catholic Church, object to as immoral or worse. And so Catholic hierarchy, along with various other religious groups, protested that this amounted to an infringement of their religious liberty. But it seems to me the more interesting question related to this has been almost entirely overlooked, and that is that the bishop who was in charge of the Catholic priests in the military's chaplain corps wrote a letter that was to be read in mass to Catholic servicemen in the mass that Sunday, and the Obama administration ordered the chaplains not to read this letter. So my understanding of Catholic liturgical theology is that a Catholic priest is a proxy for his bishop, who through apostolic succession is supposed to be a successor to the apostles, and that ultimately those bishops serve through the will of the Pope, and it's up to the Pope alone to decide what the form of liturgical services will be. So what happened here essentially was that the president, through his subordinate in the military, was usurping the authority of the Pope to say what the Catholic order of services would be. This, of course, is a kind of government intervention in Christian life that in past generations, on many, many, many occasions, led priests willingly to be martyred, that is, to be killed, rather than have the civil authorities order them not to conduct services as the Pope had instructed. And, of course, there's been similar history in the Anglican Church in England and in the Orthodox Church in Eastern Europe and the Middle East. So it seems to me that that is far and away most shockingly egregious kind of violation of the idea of religious freedom, that you have the civil authority telling priests what they can and can't say in church. Now, as I was saying before...
Professor, pardon me? Could say that James Madison would be turning over in his grave.
Well, I think that this idea of state intervention in the content of religious services is one important element of what Madison objected to about establishments. And the other thing I was going to say is that in the current Republican primary campaign, we have multiple candidates who have made a point of repeatedly saying in public what amounted to, "I'm a man of Christian faith, vote for me for that reason." And that's precisely the kind of statement that Madison refused to make. In fact, his friend Jefferson wrote that he would never say in public what his religious views were. He didn't think anybody should. He didn't think voters were entitled to know. This was not the kind of thing that people should be using as a test in voting. And Madison, after 1800, we don't have any surviving evidence of his religious views at all. He left no... no ponderings about religion. Apparently, these are among the letters that he had his wife, Dolly, destroy at his death. So we don't have any letters between James and Dolly about their affection for each other, and we don't have anything from James about his own personal religious views. And again, the reason is that he thought this should be irrelevant to political life in the United States.
Yeah, it's interesting you bring that point up about the Republican candidates, because... Much discussion has gone on about the religion, whether it's Newt Gingrich claiming to be an Orthodox, practicing Catholic, and obviously Mitt Romney being a Mormon, and Rick Santorum being very, I'm not sure what his background, it's Catholic, but I mean, I know he's very much in the evangelical camp in many ways. But interestingly, there's not much mention about Ron Paul, and I've been on his website, and he gives a Christian testimony, let's say, that is crystal clear.
yet he goes out of his way to make the point of exactly what you just said Madison's position was, that he wanted to be very careful not to be using his religion as a way to market himself, essentially. And it just brought that to mind, that many people don't realize that Ron Paul, at least privately, that's on his website as opposed to, you know, on television stuff, is very clear about his faith and very clear why he is kind of low-key about it.
Well, of course, the Constitution expressly says that there will be no religious test for office-holding, and, of course, this means by law, but, again, the full extension of the principle of leaving religion out of government was seen in Madison's refusal publicly to say what his religious views were. Now, you can make inferences from several things that he said, but there's just no flat statement from him about what his religious views were. Again, the editor of the papers of James Madison says after 1800 we don't have any such thing from him, and he lived to 1836.
Right. I mean, although on the other side, I mean, we do have to, I think, admit that and agree that somebody's religion, if they have one, does affect their perspective on what their politics are, at least their worldview and their politics and how that interacts. So it is, as far as I'm concerned, it is something that should be taken into account on an individual basis, though.
Yeah.
Well, the point that both Jefferson and Madison made about that was, as Jefferson said in that bill I referred to earlier that Madison got passed through the Virginia General Assembly, the Virginia Statute for Religious Freedom, Jefferson wrote that in requiring a man to say what his religion was, all you could do was make him a liar. That is, if we had an unwritten rule that you had to be a particular kind of Christian to get elected, we just have a lot of politicians lying about it. So that wouldn't change people's faith.
As opposed to now that they're telling the truth about it, right?
Well, I think we know that some of the people we've already referenced seem unlikely to be men of enormous faith. But the point is, we can draw that inference without having them getting up and saying, again, vote for me, I'm a Catholic, or going into private meetings with other Mormons and saying, you know, give me a lot of money because I'm a Mormon, I'm not going to mention it in public, but I'm telling my fellow Mormons. You know, this kind of thing, again, is precisely contrary to the notion of leaving religion out
of
politicking.
It's another indication of the continuing disunity or the growing disunity in the United States. We had a guest on a few months ago, Pat Buchanan, who talked about his belief that the United States is just slowly fragmenting, and one of the reasons for this is identity politics. What we're discussing right now with the religious announcements of the candidates is just another form of identity politics. So, now, moving on in the book, Madison also had a lot of very strong opinions about slavery, and especially George Mason, another Virginian, who very much against slavery, and had a lot of difficulty in dealing with it in creating and drafting the Constitution. So, you know, Madison was very concerned about a lot of these moral issues, that he knew they would be a problem for the country.
Well, I think Madison wanted to make the point in the Philadelphia Convention when people said the main divide in the country was going to be between the few large states that they thought would dominate because of population apportionment. Madison said, well, now, the real difference is not between large and small states. It's between states in which slavery is a very significant institution and those in which it isn't. The extent to which we should take that as a candid statement or one that's intended to change the line of a discussion because he was unhappy with small state delegates' insistence that there not be population apportionment, I think is rather unclear. It seems to me that if he had not really believed that but had wanted to change the subject because he was losing the argument for population apportionment of the Senate, he might have made the same exact argument. So I don't think we can really tell from that what Madison thought about this question. On the other hand, when he was an older man, he did serve for many years as the president of an organization called the American Colonization Society. And
yes,
that was because... Pardon me?
You cover that in the very last chapter of the book, how Madison worked very hard to promote his solution, which was to repatriate slaves back to Africa.
And that's right. That's exactly right.
And the foundation of the country of Liberia.
Yes. Actually, of course, yeah. It was his friend James Monroe, his successor as president, who ended up sponsoring the founding of the country of Liberia. What we need to notice about this that's interesting about Madison is that he had a quarrel over the question of why there was a difficulty in trying to reconcile the idea of black people's freedom with the idea of their living in the United States. Jefferson thought that the inequality he noticed in the country basically came down to a genetic difference between the white and black races. And Madison, on the other hand, when Jefferson said, well, I think it's possible it's environmental, it may be because of the way we're treating them, but I think it's more likely that they're just genetically inferior, both in body and mind. That's the way he put it. Madison, on the other hand, didn't believe that. He said that he thought it was environmental, and likely, given an opportunity to govern themselves, people of African descent would be able to do that. But where they did agree was when Jefferson said that he thought that white people would always be prejudiced against blacks, and blacks, because of the treatment they'd received, would always hate whites, and so the only solution was to separate the two groups. And that's where that idea of colonization came from.
Yeah, Madison was pretty far-thinking in that area. And going back, another issue that Madison dealt with that is very pertinent nowadays. You describe in the book that Madison was in favor of a one-man executive, but he rejected the idea that the executive had automatic authority to what you described as rights of war and peace, similar to the British monarchy. In other words, he didn't believe that the president could just go out and start a war, which is what we have now.
He certainly did not believe that, and in fact, it was not by accident that the Constitution ended up saying that the Congress, not the president, would be responsible for deciding to launch a war. It says declare war in Article 1, Section 8, and beside that, it also would be a joint act of the president and the Senate to make a treaty. In England, the king unilaterally, without anybody else's consent, could make a treaty and he could declare war. And the people who made the constitutional system, at least as it's written that we have, decided very thoughtfully that they didn't like the idea because they thought the executive was more likely to get the country into wars than the legislature would be. And of course, in our own lifetime, we've seen this borne out completely.
Yeah, the two things you just mentioned, starting a war and conducting a treaty, our president is doing that unilaterally right now.
That's correct, and it's been going on essentially ever since World War II. This is there hasn't been a declaration of war since World War II, and our country's had dozens of military conflicts, including the one in Libya last year.
Yeah, now you point out in the book that they changed the wording of make war to declare war, to create a subtle distinction. The Congress would have to declare war, but they also wanted to preserve the president's right to respond to an attack militarily before having actually to declare war. Very interesting point. And I hear a number of commentators nowadays, Mark Levin is one on the radio. He says that the president always has the right to make war, and it's not just defensive war, he can establish an offensive war.
Well, Mark Levin says that because he likes the idea that that's true, but a friend of mine, Tom Woods, challenged him to provide the name of one Federalist who said during the ratification contest that the president will be able to launch a non-defensive war without asking Congress, and we still hear the crickets chirping. And the reason for that is that not a single
Mark
Federalist said that. Pardon me?
Mark Levin has declined to debate Thomas Woods on that issue.
Well, of course he has, and the reason is that there's nothing for him to say. Actually, I'm the one who encouraged Tom to ask him that question, and the reason I did is because I know perfectly well there was not one single Federalist who said, if you ratify this Constitution, our president will be able to start wars without asking Congress. If anybody had said that, it wouldn't have been ratified. People would have hated the idea of one man being able to act like the English king. In fact, they had the idea that that was a monarchical behavior. So Levin, touts himself as some kind of scholar of the Constitution, but really has here either no idea what he's talking about or he's decided to prevaricate. It's one or the other. It can't be any other explanation.
Well, you know how those talk show hosts are.
Can't some trust them any farther than you can throw them, I hear.
Exactly. this is WNJC 1360 AM, and this is the Baer Haggerty Offensive, and as our guest we have Professor Kevin Gutzman, who is discussing his recent book that's just come out, I believe the other day, James Madison, Making of America. Very good book, very interesting. Kevin, one of the things that it's kind of a theme through the first part, the constitutional part, is that Madison was really instrumental in tying a lot of disparate elements and groups together during the ratification process. I mean, it's quite a job, 13 nascent states trying to agree on this Constitution, and a lot of forces pulling them apart, but here Madison is able to get the things he wants into the Constitution, and he's able to create a lot of consensus.
Hello,
Kevin?
Hello, yes. Did you want me to comment on that?
I was wondering about that. How about a question?
Well, I think there's been a lot of exaggeration historically of the extent to which Madison was able to get what he wanted out of the Philadelphia Convention. In fact, I show in the book that because some of his favorite proposals were rejected, he left the Philadelphia Convention thinking that this Constitution, even if adopted, was so inadequate that it was likely to fail within a few years. The problems he had with it were, the main ones were two. One was the one I mentioned earlier, that the Senate was not going to be apportioned by population, and not only that, but the senators were still going to be chosen by the state legislators. And Madison thought this was horrible, and really it was imperative that the state governments be cut out of choosing members of Congress. So he was just almost despondent about that. And then the other one was a proposal that he liked even better, and that was the idea that Congress should be given a veto over all state laws. He kept bringing that up repeatedly over the summer of 1787, and he kept losing and losing and losing. He called this my favorite proposition, and it ultimately was, of course, rejected. And Madison wrote a letter to Thomas Jefferson on October 24, 1787, in which he said, you know, he went into great length, a couple of pages, about why the idea of, or the notion of a federal veto of state laws was imperative, that past federations had fallen apart because the member states had adopted rules that were contrary to the central government's policy, and the only way to prevent that would have been a veto. So, again, he thought the Constitution was entirely inadequate and likely to fail.
Okay, and you talk, one of the things in the book that's very interesting, you spend a lot of time talking about the Federalist Papers and the collaboration at times between Hamilton and Madison on the writing of the Federalist, and it's pretty good. You break the Federalist Papers down into themes. There are several themes that involve more than one paper, and
right.
Some of the papers are very interesting. You seem to say that that's an important part of the creation of the Constitution. Could you comment on that?
Well, I think that the Federalist has been misunderstood in a couple of ways. One is, I think there has been a tendency to think that because the two of them ended up being essentially the founders of the competing parties in the 1790s, that Hamilton and Madison must have each written his own contribution separately. But I think if you look carefully at what the Federalist says, you can see that the two of them must have collaborated, at least in outlining several of the numbers, including the famous number 10, which picks right up on Hamilton's number 9. The other thing about the Federalist that's important to note is that in its own time, for its own purpose, it didn't really have much effect. That is, the reason for the series was to try to persuade common New Yorkers to favor the Constitution so that they would persuade their political leaders to ratify it, even though when they had the election for the New York Ratification Convention, two-thirds of the delegates who were elected had been pledged to vote no. And by all accounts, this series did not succeed in doing that. And not only that, but the series was very narrowly circulated outside New York. So you'd have a hard time pointing to anyone in the ratification process who was persuaded to vote yes by reading the Federalist. Now, on the other hand,
Kevin, the Federalist Papers really didn't have the influence that they have purported to have had.
No, they didn't have anything like it. They had exceedingly narrow, if any, influence. And as I said, ultimately, when they had the elections, and, pardon me?
That settles something very interesting for me, because you hear a lot of people quote the Federalist Papers, but what you're saying is the ratifiers just...
Listen, just add it to the long list of things that they're lying to us about. That's all.
I don't think in this case it's a lie. I think it's just easy to find that...
Everything's a lie.
It's easy to find that book on a bookshelf, and so people think, well, Hamilton, Madison, this must be the explanation. But, again, if you go read the records of, for example, the Virginia Ratification Convention, you don't find people being persuaded by it. You do hear Madison and his friend, the governor, Edmund Randolph, saying some of the same things that Madison had said in the Federalist, but you don't see any evidence that anybody's persuaded by it. And again, in New York, when they had their elections, 2/3 of the delegates were pledged to vote no, and the reason they ended up voting yes anyway was not that they were persuaded by the Federalist. So, yeah, it's been highly overhyped.
A little step back that I think you touched on. You mentioned Madison having a problem with the idea of the senators being a not elected by popular vote, essentially how it is now. But the 17th Amendment basically put us in that position. So could you just address that? It sounds like he would have been the one to propose the 17th Amendment.
Well, his problems with the structure of the Senate as it originally was structured were two. The first and more important one to him was that the apportionment was going to be what it is. In other words, that despite the different populations, the states would all have the same voice. And he thought that was a terrible violation of Republican principles. At least that's what he said. Of course, we can wonder how candid he was being in that objection, because if both houses had been apportioned by population, the state that would have had the most votes in each house was Virginia, which had the biggest population. So it's easy to make an argument we ought to have apportionment by population when your state is the biggest state. The other thing he didn't like was, he definitely wanted state governments to be out of the process.
His position went beyond what the 17th Amendment in effect did. Just like the House of Representatives, the Senate would have been.
Right. He thought that the lower house should be directly elected, and then the upper house should be elected by the lower house. And so the way that would have worked would have been that each state would have sent the U.S. House of Representatives a list of nominees, and then the House of Representatives would have chosen from among the state's nominees who the state senator would be.
Wow. Another point that it sounded like was swirling around there was the whole concept of nullification that we'd like to spend a significant amount of time on. Can you just explain that and explain where Madison fit in with that concept and where we are today with that concept, and maybe some current examples of that and how it would play out, and your understanding of how it fits in with the Constitution?
Okay. Well, the idea of nullification was developed most fully by John C. Calhoun in a document written in 1828 called the South Carolina Exposition. Vice President Calhoun picked up on the Virginia and Kentucky resolutions of 1798, which were written by Madison and Jefferson. And what Calhoun said was that, as the Virginia and Kentucky resolutions said, in case the federal government adopted a policy that was unconstitutional and dangerous, the states, and these were Madison's words from the Virginia resolutions of 1798, quote, have the right and are in duty bound to interpose. But in 1798, Jefferson for Kentucky and Madison for Virginia did not say exactly what interposing would be. And that's where Calhoun picked up in 1828 and said, okay, here's what interposing would be. The same kind of convention as agreed to the Constitution on behalf of each state could be called by a state if it thought the federal government had adopted a policy that was unconstitutional and dangerous. So if the state legislature said, for example, the tariff of 1828 is unconstitutional and dangerous, that state could call an election for a special convention that would meet and decide whether that policy was actually unconstitutional and dangerous. If they did make that decision, they could then decide that it would be nullified within that state, said Calhoun in 1828. And if it were nullified, it would be unenforced in that state until either the other states decided, 3/4 of them, that no, the nullifying state was wrong and Congress really did have the power to adopt this policy, or yes, the nullifying state was right, in which case the policy would cease to have effect anywhere in the country. Now, when the nullifiers picked up on this idea in the late 1820s and early 1830s, and they actually ended up nullifying the tariff in 1832, when they picked up on this, Madison was asked for his opinion. And What he tried to do was to distinguish between what the nullifiers were saying states could do in 1828 and what the Virginia and Kentucky resolutions of 1798 said. Madison's claim in the 1830s was that the Virginia and Kentucky resolutions did not contemplate an individual state preventing the enforcement of a federal policy. And what I show in the book, unlike other books about Madison, what I show in the book is that Madison's claim here is just incorrect. Actually, that was exactly the same thing as had been going on in 1798. That is, that the Virginia and Kentucky resolutions were about single states preventing enforcement of the Sedition Act within their own borders. And I show how Madison was inconsistent between his position on the nullification crisis and what he had said in 1798. Actually, he came to this conclusion without quite admitting it, and so in a couple of letters about this subject for public consumption, he said, well, of course, we didn't contemplate an individual state vetoing federal policy, but an individual state might have to in an extreme circumstance. So effectively, he was saying, well, you can't nullify, but you might have to. And it seems the reason for this distinction in Madison's mind was that while he thought the Sedition Act of 1798 threatened the free government in the United States, I mean, basically the Sedition Act of 1798 had made it a crime to criticize the incumbent president or the incumbent members of Congress, and so you obviously couldn't have a free election if you couldn't criticize incumbents. Madison thought that the tariff in the 1820s and 30s, while counterproductive and harmful to the South, was not unconstitutional. So he thought this was the kind of policy that shouldn't be nullified. He wanted to insist that he was consistent, but he really wasn't being.
Kevin, it's very interesting. In the book, toward the end, you do have that section on Madison's fears about nullification and how he tended to change his mind. But also, toward the end of his career, he began to support a lot of things that he would never have supported earlier in his career, such as the central bank, building a national highway and canal system. In fact, I think one politician said he was trying to out-Hamilton Hamilton. I mean, just doing things he never would have done earlier in his career.
That's true. Actually, it's interesting in regard to the national network of roads and canals. Both Jefferson, who was, of course, president from 1801 to 1809, and Madison, who was his successor in 1809 to 1817, both of them called twice in their annual messages for a national network of roads and canals. But Madison said one of those two times he made this call to Congress to adopt the policy of building a national network of roads and canals, that in case Congress found that it lacked the requisite authority, it should apply the remedy that the Constitution had thoughtfully provided, which is an elliptical Madisonian way of saying, in case this is unconstitutional, you should amend the Constitution to give yourselves power to do this. So in his last act as president, Madison ended up vetoing what was called the bonus bill, which was intended to establish a national network of roads and canals. And in his bonus bill veto message, a kind of valedictory address about how to read the Constitution, Madison said, yes, I want a national network of roads and canals, but I told you if you didn't have authority to do this, you'd have to amend the Constitution, and you didn't, so veto. You see, this is entirely unlike the way we'd expect politicians to behave now.
Yeah, well, it's interesting. I mean, if you're in the precarious position of being in Congress proposing a piece of legislation and arguing with the president who actually wrote the Constitution, could be put you at a severe disadvantage, you would think.
Well, he did shock a lot of his contemporaries, as you say, Kevin, particularly John Calhoun, who expected that bill to be passed and couldn't understand why Madison had changed his mind toward the end.
So Calhoun actually went to Madison and told him that he was sorry to give him this duty of vetoing a bill passed by his friends on his last day in office. And the Speaker of the House, Henry Clay, when he heard that Madison had vetoed the bill, said, "What? I thought it was Madison's bill." So, as I said, the way Madison had told them that if they didn't have authority, they should amend the Constitution to give themselves authority to do this kind of thing was very elliptical, and they just didn't get it. So they were shocked when he vetoed the bill.
Well, that's interesting. So getting back to the language, unconstitutional and dangerous, what would you say are some examples that might fit with that concept today?
Well,
examples today that might fit with that concept then?
Well, of course, what Madison had in mind at the time was the Sedition Act of 1798, which made it a crime to say anything that might tend to bring the president or the cabinet or the federal judiciary or the Congress into ill repute. So effectively, you couldn't criticize the president. And this wasn't just theoretical. They actually prosecuted a couple of dozen people under the Sedition Act and threw 10 in prison, including leading Republican newspaper editors. And one congressman from Vermont was thrown in jail for criticizing John Adams' foreign policy. That was clearly unconstitutional and dangerous. If you can't criticize the president, you can't have an election. You can't, you know, every election we have in America in a presidential election year is essentially about the incumbent president. If you like him, you keep him. If you don't like him, you vote for the other guy. And
this just seems eerily on point with what we opened the show with about those Obama truth squads.
It does seem related.
Sounds like that's what you're talking about.
Yeah, well, it will depend whether they actually use the force of law to punish anybody for saying anything.
We're looking at, you know, we tried to play this video and something happened. But we're looking at it and we're not sure the date on this. We see a date someplace on this video that says 08, but the whole story has to do with today. So I don't know whose mistake this is on as far as this video goes. But if it's in fact accurate, there are two prosecutors who are speaking to the news reporter, a county prosecutor and a local prosecutor, and they're talking about using sheriffs to do this. So, I mean, what do you use sheriffs and prosecutors for other than to investigate and indict and arrest? I mean, they're not using school teachers and you know, sanitation men here.
Right. Well, if what's going on is that people are being intimidated out of criticizing the president, that seems clearly along the same lines as the Sedition Act.
Well, this sounds a lot worse to me. I mean,
I don't know what could be worse than throwing a congressman in jail for criticizing the president. That seems to me to be the next thing to dictatorship.
Well, I like the idea of throwing congressmen in jail.
Yeah, I do too.
That's for criticizing the president.
Kind of getting us excited here.
Seriously, Kevin, if this proceeds the way it seems and it could proceed with actual arrests and legal action, law enforcement action against people just for criticizing or, quote, telling lies about Obama, unquote, where are we? Where do you compare our situation now to similar crises in the past? I mean, other than the Alien and Sedition Acts, how bad is this?
Well, we did have a Sedition Act during World War One, under which similar things were done. We had actually Eugene Debs, who was a socialist candidate for president, ended up being in jail when he ran for president. He got over 1 million votes. People were really offended by the idea of throwing somebody in jail for criticizing the president. I think now, though, we might hope at least that the federal judiciary would not be so wholly supportive of this kind of activity as they were in Madison's day. I mean, in 1798, when Madison was protesting the Sedition Act, the federal judiciary was composed entirely of Federalists because there'd only been two presidents and they were both Federalists. And those judges were actively and energetically seeking out people to prosecute and then running rigged trials to ensure that they were convicted. In fact, there's a case of Justice Samuel Chase in which he told people before he went to Virginia to sit on a circuit court there that when he got there, he was going to have a certain man indict. He was going to have a grand jury impanel. He was going to tell them to indict this guy. They're going to have a trial. The man was going to be convicted, and he was going to give him the fullest possible sentence. And that's exactly what happened. So
yeah,
that, to me, I don't think, although I'm, of course, one of the loudest critics of the federal judiciary in academia, I don't think we would think that at least that most federal judges would act like that. But
we would hope not. But, you know, you point out a lot of instances similar to those in your other book, Who Killed the Constitution?
Right.
You know, you do have those stories from World War One and
right.
other instances where the Constitution is slowly being chipped away. And you're saying you hope other judges don't do that, but the climate in the country seems to be tending that way. You know, I have your book, Who Killed the Constitution, in front of me, and right on the front cover is a blurb by Judge Andrew Napolitano promoting your book. And, of course, you know what happened to him last week. He was fired from his job. Now, there's nothing unconstitutional there. Fox News can do whatever they want, but to me, that's just another degree of chilling against the speech that the establishment doesn't like.
Well, Dan, you did see that video that came about a week or so before he was fired, right?
Was that the video where he says, "What if?"
Yes, it was the "What if." I don't know if he's done these before, but yeah, the "What if" video, and basically it was a total indictment against the both political parties without exception. I mean, it was a stinging indictment against both political parties, and it was beautiful.
Did you happen to see that? Are you aware of that, Kevin?
I have seen that. It's actually older than you're saying. I saw it several weeks ago. I think there actually was a recent vote in the Senate on an amendment to the National Defense Authorization Act that was more worrisome than this. I mean, for the first time in American history, the president was enabled to hold American citizens indefinitely without trial. And as I say, the vote was 93-7 in the Senate. The president said while this debate was going on in Congress that if that amendment were included in the bill, he would veto it, but then he didn't, and he issued a signing statement that said, "Oh, I won't enforce this." But of course, the fact that he doesn't enforce it, even if he doesn't, which is dubious, but the fact that he doesn't enforce it doesn't remove the provision from the statute books, so now the presidents are entitled to jail American citizens indefinitely. That seems to me extremely worrisome.
So that's directly in it's against the Bill of Rights, one of Madison's efforts.
Truly, yes.
That's an outrage.
You know, even the distinction between saying, you know, that the focus is on American citizens, the implication is that if you're a legal resident or even a visitor here, that you don't have any constitutional protection is obviously a problem too, correct?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, it's like we keep talking about it being, that the climax of this is that it has to do with citizens. But I mean, think if somebody's visiting from another country and the federal government decides for whatever reason or no reason at all they're gonna drag you out of your hotel room and tuck you away someplace. I mean, it sounds like this would effectively authorize this.
Well, what this allows them to do is to do that very thing to American citizens as well. But the point you're making actually is related to a dispute that Madison was involved in again in 1798, because along with the Sedition Act, the Congress adopted in 1798 another bill called the Alien Act, and that enabled the president to expel aliens he judged dangerous. That is, there was no judicial process involved at all. And the Republicans, Madison's friends in Congress, and Madison's fellows in Republican leadership said that just because you're a foreigner doesn't mean that you don't have procedural protections under the American Constitution. And on the other hand, the Federalists, the Hamiltonians, the people who were running the government, John Adams' party, said, no, if you're an alien, it's as if you're a guest in someone's house. You don't have the same rights as the person who owns the house or his children. So ultimately in 1800 elections, the Jeffersonian position won, but we have occasionally seen people bring up that Federalist idea again. And basically what it amounts to is that through history there are always people who want to argue government's power is unlimited, it can do whatever we want. And there are other people, Madison's side of the dispute, who say, no, government should have limited powers. That's what being free is.
Yeah, well, Kevin, we have about 5 minutes left. How concerned are you about this seeming threat that we're under at this point from specifically the federal government? I mean, has it accelerated in the past years, or I mean, how do you see this playing out?
Well, I think that what's happened over time is we've gotten away from the idea of constitutional government. I mean, anybody who reads my book, James Madison and the Making of America, is going to see that the point of having a constitution is precisely to provide limits on the powers of people, especially in Congress, but in government generally. That's what this dispute we were just discussing about the Sedition Act and the one about the Alien Act and the question of the power of federal government to build interstate highways and so on. These are all about the question of limits on the powers of people in government. If we get away completely from the idea that the government's powers are limited, then we don't have any freedom except so far as they decide they don't intend to take our rights away from us today. I mean, if government can do whatever it wants, eventually it's going to get around to doing it to you. And this, to me, is the opposite of constitutional government. It's certainly the opposite of James Madison's understanding of constitutional government. And I do think, like you, that the trend is accelerating. And, you know, it's a bipartisan tendency. And in my lifetime, I'm 48, it certainly has seemed to be picking up steam. I don't know exactly what there is right now that people in the federal government wouldn't think they're entitled to tell us to do or to do to us.
Well, it just seems like, I mean, given human nature, if the federal government or any government, state government included, can do whatever they want, eventually they will. And I think
that's what Madison said in Federalist 51. We didn't talk about that earlier, but the whole point of that classic contribution to American political science is that people in office are going to want all the money, sex, power, and fame they can get, and you just take that for granted. So the reason why the federal constitution employs the principle of checks and balances, I think imperfectly, as we've seen through our history, but the reason they tried to incorporate the principle of checks and balances into the federal constitution was that they assumed that every Obama and McConnell and Pelosi and Reid and Boehner and all these people are going to want all the power they can get. The only way to keep them from exercising unlimited power is to set them in opposition to each other through the institutional structure. Well, the structure has, as I said, proven imperfect. Now they tend to ignore it altogether. But the fact, the psychological insight that Madison had remains accurate. People still want all the power they can get, and they will take your rights if you let them.
Kevin, let me ask you a philosophical question here. The Constitution that we had, it's been slowly devolved into a Constitution we don't have anymore, I guess you might say. Is the Constitution that they gave us, that we inherited, is it a workable document, or are there inherent flaws? I mean, Obama seemed to imply, and he said that the Founding Fathers didn't quite get it right. Did the Founding Fathers get it right, and we're just not enforcing it, or do we need a new document?
Somebody like Madison...
minutes to answer that.
Well, I actually think that we find an answer to that question in Madison's own writing, and that is, again, in The Federalist, where he said, essentially, that the system that was being established, that would be established under this proposed Constitution, would give the people the opportunity to protect Republican government. Now, he didn't think it was inevitable. In fact, he was very skeptical about the prospects for freedom in general. But he thought that if you had an engaged, attentive, educated citizenry, that was the best, that was the way to have the best likelihood of retaining a free society. And I think, of course, what we've ended up with is a detached, essentially uneducated, uninterested electorate, and so we have people saying, you know, vote for me and I'll give you a free house and free medical care and ensure that you go to school for free and you have a car, and you know, this is all possible if only we have the right amount of currency inflation. And, you know, it's demagoguery, but it's not anything that anybody would have been surprised by. Now, of course, the mechanisms are in the document. We could make it work if we wanted to amend the Constitution to take these problems that have developed over time into account. It's just that we don't, and we can only blame our fellow citizens and ourselves for that.
So, Kevin, 30 seconds, what's the prognosis?
The prognosis? Oh, I'm a historian, not a theologian. I'm not offering hope.
No hope, huh?
Seems like most of our shows end that way lately, Dan. It's kind of depressing, but we're doing our job to try to educate the public, whoever's listening to us. Our guest has been Kevin Gutzman, discussing his new book, which just came out, and I highly recommend. It's called James Madison and the Making of America. Very interesting book.
Hey, Kevin, great having you on again. We look forward to another time we could discuss maybe your next book or continue on this topic, whether it's on this book, another book, all your books. These topics are just They're very obviously very germane to what's going on today, and we thank you for being on with us.
Thank you, Kevin.
I look forward to being on again. You're welcome.
Very good. It's Billy and Dan, Baer Haggerty Offensive, Repatriot Radio, out.